For those who don't know me, my name is Paul Vander Clay. I'm Stan's son. If you call me Stan, I won't be surprised. People often do that. And so I was Glenda's nephew, and she had all the nephews and nieces call her Tanta. And so I'll probably refer to her in that way. When Uncle Bud asked if I'd say some things, and he mentioned the Romans 12 passage, and I read the Romans 12 passage, I thought, that is such a wonderful passage. And then I saw that Pastor Harrison was going to speak out, I thought, oh no, what am I going to do? Because now that he's pointed that passage, I read that passage, because I'm thinking, what verse encapsulates her? And I saw that passage, I thought, it fits so well, but he's already speaking about it. And then Wednesday, it's going to be fun to watch Uncle Bud and Kara, because these two are, you know, Kara, your mother spent 56 years trying to keep a leash on him and never succeeded. So
I will.
I'll leave that with you. But Wednesday, Kara talked to me and she said, the verse that's going through my mind is Joshua 1, verse 9. And I thought, oh, that's interesting. I've never heard that at a service, at a memorial service. And then yesterday when I was preparing the message, I read it and I thought, this is the perfect text for me to speak on. After the death of Moses, the book of Joshua begins. And I think it's okay for me to read a little scripture, because I noticed my brother James got up, and before he read scripture, he told a story. So I'm supposed to tell stories, but I'm going to read a little scripture too. All right. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord. Now I also know, and all of us knew, that Tata had a terrific sense of humor. And fortunately, Hiram and Grace, her parents, gave each of their three children the ability to laugh at themselves. So our family gatherings are loud and filled with laughter, and that's always how the home was filled when we came to Tata and Uncle Bud's. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give to you every place you set foot on, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite countries to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you, and do not turn from it from the right or the left, that you may be successful in whatever you do. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. That was the perfect passage. Now, one thing that I've learned as a pastor is that when people start telling someone something, there's a reason they're telling them. And if the Lord tells Joshua three times, be strong and courageous, it probably means Joshua was anything but that. Because for him, Moses was Moses. Moses who parted the Red Sea. Moses who led them through the wilderness. Moses who hung in them with there for 40 years of wandering until a generation died. He was Moses. And Joshua looked at himself and thought, I could never be Moses, because Joshua knew himself and all his failures. But if you read the book of Exodus, you know Moses wasn't always Moses. He was a failed liberator, and then he was a shepherd. And by the time the Lord called him at the age of 80, he had every excuse in the world to not follow. But the Lord wouldn't take it from him. And he called him. Now, I know Tonto was your Moses. And what Shirley said is very true. Tonto was ready to go, but she fought so hard because she said, I have mine here to care for. And I need to be here for them. But the strangest thing in this story is Moses doesn't get to the promised land. Joshua has to bring them in. And so the Lord says, be strong and courageous. But the thing that we should know is that Tonto wasn't always Tonto. She was that little girl that told her younger brother, Dave, Stan got the brains, I got the looks, there is nothing left for you. And I don't feel too badly taking a little time this morning, because if you all were her friends, I know you've got the capacity to sit and listen. Because she inherited from her mother the storytelling gene. Uncle Dave has it too. My father inherited the Hiram gene of listening, which is important, because where there's a storyteller, there needs to be a listener. I take it out, Eugene, you have that too. On my last visit to Grand Rapids, when my son was graduating from Calvin, Tonto told me a story I hadn't heard before. She told me about when they moved from Lytton, Iowa to Owen Sound, Ontario. And she was about your age, Alec, when they moved. And this was a difficult time. The church in Canada, back in those days, the church would just send a call letter, and this pastor's supposed to say yes or no. And Hiram and Grace struggled with that letter so much. She told me, in fact, Hiram walked over to the post office to mail the letter sometime during the day, and he didn't come back for hours, and Grace was worried about him. And the reason he was gone so long was he knew the letter said, I would accept, but he did not want to go. And if you knew Grace at all, she did not keep her opinions and feelings close to the vest with respect to these things. She did not want to go, and so, but he mailed the letter, came back that evening, and she said, where were you? I struggled so much, but I believe this is what God is calling us to do. And so they moved from Lytton, Iowa to Owen Sound, Ontario, and they moved into the parsonage. And Glenda was angry and hurt and sad because a girl her age leaving all of her friends, and then they went to Canada, and she said that the children in school, they all believed that American schools, American children were uneducated, and American schools were poor, and everything was bad in America. And she came there with a chip on her shoulder, and so every day she went to school, and she felt like she had to defend herself. And so every night she got home, and she would go into her room at bedtime, and she would cry. You know, we know that David has the reputation for the one in the family who cries, but she told me that it was Glenda. We've got stories for you too, Uncle Dave, don't worry. And every night she cried in her room, and her room was close enough so that Hiram and Grace could hear her. And I'm sure her cry wasn't just, I'm sad, it was, I'm angry, and she told me, my cry was a complaint. I did not want to be there. And so every night she would cry, and if you knew Hiram, he was gentle and kind and patient, and he would walk to the room and he would sit down with her and try to console her. And she would tell him exactly why an injustice had been done to her, and she didn't want to be there. And this went on night after night, and I can imagine Hiram and Grace in their bedroom asking, what have we done? And so she said, one night, I heard him coming to the room, and the footsteps were different. And he came into the room, because Hiram did have his limits. Dave's got those stories too. The footsteps were different, and he sat down and he said, if you cannot stop crying, I'm afraid I'm going to have to find a doctor for you. But I'd like you to know something. I don't want to be here. Your mother doesn't want to be here. You know we left your brother in Iowa, a junior in high school. None of us want to be here. But we believe the Lord called us to be here. Now, what he knew, and probably what she couldn't appreciate, was that this was just after the war. And men and women were leaving the Netherlands, which had been torn by war. And they didn't have the language for it then, but these people were filled with trauma. And they came to a place like Owen Sound, Ontario, and they couldn't get along. They were quarrelsome. They were angry. They had all the stuff from the war stuffed in them. And finally, when they got to Canada, it all came out, and they fought with each other. And often people would come in the train and no one was there to pick them up. And so the railroad guy said, I'll call the Dutch preacher. And Tante told me that in the night, Grandma would wake her up and say, slide over. And they knew immigrants were coming, and Hiram and Grace gave them the bedroom. And so Hiram would sleep with Dave, and Grandma would sleep with Tante. And Grandma would make some eggs and care for them, and finally when they got things sorted out, the immigrants would go on their way, and sure enough, it would happen again and again and again. You see, Moses wasn't always Moses. She learned the hospitality and the care and the devotion to the Lord from hard things. And so that night was the last night she cried. And you all know that her life was full of many good things. This morning at the gravesite, we thought it's going to rain on us because when we're in the woods with the Welmers, it rains every camping trip. Uncle Bud hasn't burned any chicken yet. I missed game night, apparently, but if you played games with her, she was terribly competitive, as her mother was. But Moses wasn't always Moses, and your mother wasn't always her mother. And you all know the hard things that she's lived through. You know the disappointments. You know the pains. You know the struggles. Because character is seldom formed by the good times. It's almost always formed by the pains and the trials and the calls for sacrifice. And that's what made her her. Now, here's the thing. Often the promised land looks very unpromising. And I know what you all look at now is, how can we go forward without her? When we come to the house, she's not there. When we lift up the phone, she won't be on the other end. When I'm angry or sad or hurt and don't know what to do with myself, where will I go? See, Ruth brought her up that way. She got used to her. My dear sister storming over from Calvin with all of her problems. Where will she be? And that's where this text comes to play. Believe it or not, you are going to the promised land. The Lord has good things for your future. You don't know what they are. And remember that the first foray into the promised land, the spies came out and said, there's giants there, we can't go. And so the Lord says, and I think you picked exactly the right verse, Kevin. Be strong and courageous, for I will go with you, says the Lord. She isn't here right now. Moses didn't see the promised land. But we must be bold and courageous. And like Moses, she has now received her reward. She doesn't need to be bold and courageous. She is at peace. But I believe that, in fact, the word you gave me is God's word to you.